said, why are you against it? This is just as good as it can happen. And certainly as Sue said at the beginning, clearly it's not just a sporting event. It's something which is profoundly anti-democratic, which is popular only in the sense that we're spectators and that those people have very little say or influence in the way that decisions are made. And that was certainly true for the issue around the sighting of an operations base on one of the flats in East London. Local residents only found out about that when it was leaked to the standards. And it was only after there was a large public meeting with over 200 people in Forest Gate that the police went into overdrive with the corporation and the City of London Corporation to manage one of flats to try and make sure that they were getting across their message. That campaign has been going on since June 2010. There have been a series of different events that have been organised and a long process of trying to lobby Parliament and a judicial review of the Home Secretary in relation to the decision making. And I'll go on and explain a little bit more about some of the things that happened in a bit.
Can you just say
it's
a police operation place?
It's a police operation place, that's correct. But the point being is that it's one feature of the way that many of us feel that East London is going to increasingly feel like we're being invaded. That essentially there is an occupation force in place around the Olympics. And most people would have heard or certainly seen some of the detail around the numbers in the press. 23,700 security personnel, that's national and private. 13,000 soldiers. 2 days ago it was announced that they will be in uniform. Up to 9,000 police officers, and also private security guards with a contract to G4S. I don't want to focus quite so much on the issue around MOD personnel, although for some people that's more exciting. Partly because I think that the impact of the Olympics is more likely to be felt on the streets by people who live in the host boroughs. Some of the key issues that we've identified, I mean, the first obvious one is about the use of police powers. There is an expectation that there will be not only greater use of existing powers, but the potential for new restrictions and orders to be brought in over the next couple of months. And people would have seen the thing just this week about the ban on tents and encampments anywhere around the Olympic venues. Specifically in relation to police powers, there's a couple of things that we're very worried about, one of which is the use of stop and search. In particular, the use of something called Section 60 stop and searches, which don't require reasonable suspicion that you're committing some form of crime, and it's within a designated area, which is almost certainly going to be the whole of Stratford, and certainly around the other sites as well. The other one is a slightly more obscure piece of legislation, which is the Police Reform Act 2002 and Section 50 of that, which makes it an offence for people to refuse to give their name and address if an officer has reasonable suspicion that you may be engaged in antisocial behaviour, which from the evidence of where that's been used so far is a very broadly drawn definition. And so, I mean, admittedly, both of these things so far have had the greatest impact on young people. There is the issue around private security. Specifically, an example just in the last week, there was somebody, a photographer, who was approached by G4S security and who called the police because somebody was taking a photograph of the entrance to the Westfield shopping centre. Now, I genuinely thought that we'd got over that issue about stopping and persecuting photographers when there was a campaign on photographer not terrorists over the last couple of years. Mm. And we saw the ending of the misuse of Section 44 anti-terrorism powers to harass and intimidate photographers. But it's an example of where you're going to have security guards who are poorly trained, who don't understand the law, and basically think they can do what they like. And there is also the issue about the type of people who frankly want to volunteer to be security guards. So I think that's something we need to be aware of. In relation to the issue around encampments, I mean, I mentioned a bit about what I wanted plans. There will be site which is fenced off, which is around about 4 acres, which will have 2,000 police in and out of that site, a bus leaving from there going to the Stratford once every 15 minutes. There are many concerns about what impact that will have for people living locally in terms of whether there will be an exclusion zone around it, what will happen if you walk too closely. One of the things that the campaign is going to be doing is focusing on monitoring the impact of that base on the local community and certainly marking the beginning and end of its occupancy of what is supposedly protected public land. There will be a community picnic that we're organising on Sunday the 10th of June, which is 2 weeks before the site is taken over, and we'll be coming back at the end to reclaim that land when it's when the police leave around about the middle of September. So what else practical is happening around the issue of addressing security? Yeah. Network for Police Monitoring, is, I mentioned, is a coalition of a number of groups, including Green and Black Cross, FitWatch, Legal Defence Monitoring Group, predominantly focused around leading serving. And the local member of that, which is going to be leading on much of this, is the new monitoring project, which I've been involved in for the last 20 years and has been focusing on a number of the issues that I talked about. In terms of practicalities, we will be organising workshops around East London on people's rights. We'll be producing a rights card. There will be a 24-hour Olympics telephone helpline. We'll be doing training and deploying community legal observers around, particularly around Stratford, but basically anywhere where there's going to be, where we can get enough volunteers to do that, where there are Olympic venues. And we are at this organised conference in Newham, which is specifically around issues of policing and security for local communities, which we're hoping to do actually during the Olympics itself. Obviously, we need to be fluid and we need to be able to respond. One of the things that I think NetPol is, in a wider sense, is concerned about is the surveillance of dissent, by which I mean the people in this room, and the impact of just trying to keep tabs on what people like ourselves are doing. I think it is very important to emphasise that despite the fact that there will be heavy security, that this is not a reason for us to back away from exercising the legitimate right to public protest. Just because the Olympics is happening, that right cannot be suspended. And on a sort of personal note, I mean, some people who know me will know that I've rather frivolously been running an anti-Olympics poster competition on my website over the last couple of weeks. And it did occur to me that perhaps we should be thinking about perhaps having gold, silver, and bronze medals for the best acts of rebellion.
Yes. Yes.
So to paraphrase Lord Sebastian Psycho,